Okay, good afternoon, everybody. We'll just wait for another half a minute or so for latecomers and then start. Okay, so good afternoon. We'll be starting the class now, but before going into this, since today is the first class, before going into the subject itself, I'll just give a brief introduction about myself as well as we'll discuss about the routine, the slots. So latecomers still coming in. Okay, so I've briefly put on my video so that you can see my face. Since the pandemic started when you were, I think, just at the end of the first year, isn't it? So you may not have seen me in the department, but anyway, I am Professor Smita Sadhu, and I did my BE from your department itself, our department, that is, Jadavpur University, and that was way back in 1991. And then I did my master's and PhD in what was then the Bengal Engineering College, IIESC, as you know it now. And then I came back to Jadavpur University to join as a research scholar in a defense project, and finally started as a faculty member here, right? So what I'll do is, I'll of course switch off the video now, my video that is, because it's unnecessary. Just to show you who I am, I just put it on. So, okay. Now, first of all, I had asked for a list of students with the details, but it did not reach me. So far, I have not got it. So, who is the CR of the class? Is he present, he or she? Who is an CR? What happened? You've forgotten the name in 2 years?
Ma'am, I think none of them is present.
Okay. So anyway, if actually, thank you for telling me that. If the CR doesn't send me a list, maybe one of you would have to take the initiative of sending me a list of the names, roll numbers, phone numbers, and emails, because it often happens that later on some problem arises, and as well as I would like to know the emails of the students themselves, because sometimes I get emails from unofficial, unofficial in the sense that unaccounted accounts, and usually do not respond to those. So I would want a list as early as possible. But I've actually tried to download the roll sheets from the JUMS website, where though I'm sure many may not be continuing with the class or vice versa, meaning that some students may be there whose names are not in that list and all that. Okay. So what I'll do is, because today is the first class, I'll just, call out your names if you are there. If you can just briefly for a few seconds put on your video so that I can just see your face and then you can switch it off. Okay, so I'll just take the attendance first for today's class. Okay, we'll later on, of course, I'll decide what to do, whether to start off with the class first and then take the attendance at the end, or whichever is convenient for me, that I'll follow. But today, particularly, I would like to just take the attendance first because it is the first class. So just respond. I would like to see how many are actually there today. Okay, Arnav Bothra, are you there? Monica Bishash, Aritra Mojumdar, Gopal Devda. Aritra Mojumdar is
Yes,
there?
ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, but I didn't see your face. Aritra, can you just show me your face briefly?
Okay, ma'am.
Aritra, okay, this is Gopal. Okay, thank you, that's all. Okay,
Okay, ma'am.
Gopal, you can switch it off. Aritra? Aritra
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Mojumdar? Just switch on your video if it is possible, just to show me your face. That's it.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. So your classmates also will be able to see that you're in good shape and condition, right? Okay. You can switch it off, no problem. Arnodeep Shaha.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Okay. Thank you. That's it. Sushovan Sharkar.
Present, ma'am. Ma'am, I don't have a camera on my laptop.
Okay. Orko Prabhu Haldar.
Present, ma'am.
Okay, thank you. Arnab Chakraborty. Arnab Chakraborty. Shayan Kumar Nag. Megha Gorai or Gorai, right? Megha. Arijit Mondol.
Listen, ma'am.
Okay. Is your camera working? Can you show me your face if it is possible? Arijit. Okay. Thank you. Next is Himadri Dash.
Present, ma'am. Present, ma'am.
I've marked you present, but I want to see your face if
Oh,
it is
yes,
possible.
ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Sorry, ma'am. There's a power shortage in our area. That's
Okay,
all.
I'll see your silhouette today. The next day class, I'll see your face. Okay, thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
Ahon Basu. Ahon. Okay, thank you. Piyush Agarwal. Sahil Singh.
Yes, ma'am.
Where are you? Okay. Okay, thank you. Ovirup Sharkar. Ovirup. Okay. Shekhar Dash. Yes. Okay. Shekat. Shekat. Okay, Pushpal Banerjee.
Present, ma'am.
Okay. Can you switch on your video briefly? Okay, thank you. आपको प्रभु नंदी
प्रेजेंट मैम
ओके राइट थैंक यू आबिद हसन आबिद जशीमुद्दीन मंडल
प्रेजेंट मैम
ओके कैन यू शो अस योर फेस जशीमुद्दीन ओके थैंक यू Chayo Katta.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Right. Thank you. Ayun Kuiri. Rajdeep Shamanto. Nehashish Banerjee.
Present, ma'am.
Ashish, can we see you? Yes. Okay, thank you. That's it. Shubroto Dalal.
Present, ma'am.
Okay, thank you. Shahrukh Ali, Sheikh Shahrukh Ali.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Okay, thank you, Shahrukh. Doipan Guho. Dwipayon?
Yes, ma'am. Present.
Okay. Okay. Thank you. Ranjit Mahato. Pushpal Tarufdar.
Present, ma'am. Present.
Okay. Thank you. In your face. Okay. Ashmita Mukherjee. Thank you, Pushpal. Ashmita. Raisa Chatterjee. Tinmoy Kumar. Nirmallo Nandi. Devanjan. Okay, Nirmallo. Okay, thank you. Thank you, Nirmallo. Devanjan Sharkar. Annesha Dan, I think anyway. Annesha, Shamaita Chaudhuri, Dipayon Paul, Shamim Hawk, Vishal Barman.
Yes, ma'am.
Vishal. Can we see your face, Vishal?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. I have on my camera.
Okay. Okay, thank you, Vishal. Agniv Chatterjee.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Yes. Thank you, Agniv. Abu Said Sheikh Anand Chakraborty.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you. Motibur Rahman, Debraj Banerjee, Moshmi Sarin.
Yes, ma'am.
Moshmi. Yes, Moshini. Can we see you if possible? Okay, thank you. Alamin Islam, Mohammed Mubassar Alam, Nidya, Amisha Parveen.
Yes, ma'am.
Amisha. Okay, thank you, Amisha. Anushree Majumdar.
Present, ma'am.
Okay, thank you, Anushree. Jayanto Mandol.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you, Jayanto. Shobhik Nag. तो विग्नाग ओके यस यस व्हाट हैपेंड कैमरा नॉट वर्किंग अच्छा ओके इट्स ओके फाइन क्या है उत्तर It's okay, sure. No problem.
Present, ma'am.
Okay, thank you, Jayat. Shushmit Rudra.
Present, ma'am.
Okay, thank you, Shushmit. Debolina Chaudhuri. Rabin Chalak. Rishabh Mahajan. अमृता माल विप्रदाश मंडल
प्रेजेंट मैम
विप्रदाश ओके थैंक यू विप्रदाश ओके शोभिक हैज मैनेज्ड समहाउ ओके थैंक यू शोभिक यस वी कैन सी यू शोभिक नाग रूपलेखा रॉय रूपलेखा रॉय
यस मैम
ओके थैंक यू रूपलेखा वेंड्रिला हल्दार
यस मैम
कैन वी सी योर फेस वेंड्रिला यस ओके थैंक यू रुक्षंदा हुसैन
प्रेजेंट मैम
ओके Yes, thank you. Anubhav Roy.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, okay, Anubhav, thank you. Rudronil Shardar. Polumi Dash.
Yes, ma'am.
Polumi, yes. Can we see your face, Polumi?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, okay. Thank you. Obhijit Dash. Manjur Alam Midde. Ramchandra Hembram. Nayan Sharin.
Yes, ma'am.
Nayan, right? Okay.
Yes,
ma'am. Okay. Okay, Nayan, thank you. Sharuk Murmu. Rajeshri Bhattacharya.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you. Jyotirindra Sarkar.
Yes, ma'am.
Shashwat Mukherjee. Okay, thank you, Shashwat. Shostik Kanjilal. Okay.
Present, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you, Shostik. Vinay Kumar Rajak. Vinay. Okay, thank you, Vinay. Yunus Ahmed, Mohammed Yunus Ahmed.
Present, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you, Yunus. Shomi Vikash.
Present, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you, Shomi. Akash Singh Roy.
Present, ma'am.
Can we see your face, Akash?
My video is not working.
Okay, no problem. Okay, no problem, Akash. Devonik Borua.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Okay, thank you, Devonik. That's it. So that about sums up the attendance of all of you who are present now and today, that is. Now, as far as the class is concerned, you must have noted the timing of the class, that is Thursday 2:30 to 3:30, and after that 3:30 to 4:30 you find that there is MM/SS written over there in your routine. So basically, I mean, I'm sure you are familiar with that notation. You know what it means? Have you had classes like that where two teachers were actually put, names were put? Actually, I mean, if it were a, class in the university classroom, what we would have done is that 1 week MM would have taken, Professor MM, that is, Professor Madhubanti Mahatra, and the other week I would have taken the class, that specific class, that is, that specific slot, 3:30 to 4:30. That is the way we used to do if, normal classes would have been held. But now what has happened is that since there is a bit of flexibility, I will usually try to, have you spoken with Professor MM? That is, has she taken a class with you already? Mm. Has the linear control system other part started, part two?
No, ma'am.
Okay. So basically what I will do is I will take this class, that is 2:30 to 3:30, and on most days I will extend it a bit, so that, I mean, about half an hour, so that I will not be, I mean, alternately changing between, usually what would have happened is that 1 week I would have taken two classes, the next week I would have taken one class, again the following week I would have taken two classes, and that is the way it would have, there would have been an alternating. But now, I mean, I propose that what I will do is, when I take the class, if everything goes well, I will extend it to around four or something. Maybe not be today's class, because it's the introductory, let's see when we can finish, but henceforth I will take the class almost up to 4 o'clock, right? So so that would be the slot every week for your linear control system. Now, as far as the subject is concerned, what I'm going to teach is linear control system, and I will be teaching you part one of the subject. So I'll do something, that is, I usually record my classes because of several reasons. So I'll start the recording and then I'll actually start projecting the slide so that you can follow. Just give me a moment. Okay, so is the slide visible? Can you see the slide that I'm projecting?
Yes, ma'am.
Oh, okay, fine. So yes, basically, ma'am. Okay. So the subject that I will be teaching is linear control system. It's written over there. That's why I wanted to project it. And I'll be teaching part one. Actually, I teach part one. Nowadays, I teach part one to both the sections, whereas part two will be taught by Professor Madhubanti Mahatra, that is the abbreviation MM that you see in your routine. She will be teaching part two of linear control system. So as far as the this presentation goes, and as far as the notes, actually, as we call it, go, the notes were prepared and compiled by, of course, myself, that is this, Professor Smita Sadhu that you see over here, plus a senior professor who used to earlier teach in the department, unfortunately, Professor K. Datta, who used to teach the subject earlier, he has expired. But nevertheless, I've kept his name over here because a large portion of what is taught, the content, was compiled by him. But nevertheless, I will be teaching part one to both the sections in this semester. It's not changing. So, can you see this next slide? That is, syllabus is written over this slide number. Let me write that. Okay. Slide number two, where you see the syllabus. I hope it's visible.
No, ma'am. Still, no? The first slide is only visible. Yeah, ma'am. Now the syllabus is visible.
Let me see full screen mode. Can you see it now?
Yeah, ma'am. Now the syllabus is visible.
Visible. Okay. So basically, the part one, the syllabus written over here, you need not really copy that because it is first of all in the university website, as well as I'll be giving you the PDF of this note in installments. Installments means that when I will be finishing a particular module, say for example, if I finish the introduction and the first portion part, then after two or three classes, I'll be giving you that portion of the notes. I usually do not give the whole of the slides together at one go, but you will get it. So, you need not note what is already, there in the university website as well as on this slide, but most of it is going to be covered over here. So you see part one over here. The reference books listing is as per what was given in the, when the syllabus was published. But I will actually go to the next slide. I hope you can see that references slide. If anytime the slide is not visible, if I'm speaking something and you see that the corresponding slide is not visible, please let me know. So now I'm projecting the references slide because sometimes there seems to be a lag. Hope you can see the references slide.
No, ma'am. Still, the syllabus slide is visible.
So I better get out of the full screen mode, I think. Can you see the references slide? Okay,
yeah,
so what I'll do is, let me just make this bigger and do it from here because. Okay. So the references slide is here, and over here you can see several books are referred to. The first one is Control System Theory by Professor Sushil Dashgupta, and it's Khanna publisher book. Unfortunately, that book is not available as a soft copy, right? You can still buy the book in bookshops, but a soft copy is not available. Some portion of what I would be teaching would be from that book, but you need not really, under this situation, you need not really, hunt for that book if you do not have a copy. If you have it or if you can get it from any senior or anyone, that is fine. Or if somebody gets a copy and tries to scan and share among you, that's fine. But as far as I am concerned, I have a copy, but it is in the university lab, departmental lab. So, my lab, that is. So with me at home, I do not have a copy as well. And even if I had a copy, I would not, actually be able to scan the whole book because it's quite a thick one. So, the reference, of course, just make a note that it is a good book. If you get your hands on it, you can refer to it. The next one, Nagrath Gopal, Control Systems Engineering, is a very popular book. And it is available as a soft copy as well. So you would or should be able to lay your hands on one, that is the soft copy. Similarly, the next one, Modern Control Engineering by K. Ogata, and the next one, that is Automatic Control Systems by B.C. Kuo, Benjamin Kuo. and then you have, I'll tell you which are more important compared to others, but let me just read out the list first. Automatic Control Systems by Taylor and Brown. Then Control Systems Engineering by Norman Nisei or Nyes, and Control Systems by Naresh Sinha. So as far as this list is concerned, you can see it's quite a long list over here, about 7 books that you see, of which now this book by Naresh Sinha, I will only be teaching a specific portion, that is compensation of control systems from this. So you need not really look around for this, because if we do reach to that portion, and I will give you almost a thorough sort of notes which are made from Naresh Sinha, which you would not be requiring to supplement anything from the book, possibly. And also, because you can see over here, it's an Indian author book and not very readily available on the net, you will not be able to get a soft copy as well. That is my, I think so. So basically, you need not look around for Naresh Sinha if you are not, if you are not able to, right? Taylor and Brown actually is a book. If you get hold of it, you can just refer to it. But now, as far as the books are concerned, textbooks, you can use, number one is Nagrath Gopal, number two is Ogata, number three is Benjamin Kuo, number four is Norman Nisei. So these, that is the second, third, fourth, and sixth books over here, any one of them, if you lay your hands on, it would more or less suffice. Suffice means it is going to be sufficient. You can, of course, then supplement the material from other books. But I, as far as my knowledge goes, all of these are available as soft copies. This Nagrath Gopal, you can just note the books, these books that I'm stating over here, because it will, you will get the slides after a delay of 1 or 2 weeks. So Nagrath Gopal, you can just note the author names, that will be sufficient, because all are either Control Systems Engineering or Model Control Engineering, Automatic Control System, something like that. Control Systems or Control Engineering, the keyword is already there. It's going to be easy for you to search. The author names are important. So Nagrath Gopal or Ogata or Kuo or Norman Nisei. Those are the 4 books, out of which you essentially should have one book with you. The others you can refer to. Of course, since we are speaking about ebooks and soft copies and all that, you can as well, save all 4 of those with, you. And then you can actually just go by one book and refer to others if necessary. As far as this book is concerned, Automatic Control Systems, it used to be authored by Benjamin Kuo till, I'm not very sure, I think 11th edition or something, 9th, 10th, I'm sure it was only B.C. Kuo. Now, there is a second author whose name has been added, starting with G. Kholnargi or something. I'm not able to pronounce that. But it is, the book is the same book. So if you get your, if you get your soft copy, it is more probable that you will be getting the combined author book by Kuo and someone else. But that is the same book. So, same book in the sense, some minor editing done, some MATLAB problems added, and so on. Really cosmetic changes are there, but not, as far as the core material is concerned, it remains the same. So that is as far as the references are concerned, right? Now, I will today actually give you a brief introduction to what control system is. Of course, the name of your course is Linear Control System. We will see, why linear, and if it was not linear, what would it, what it would have been, and so on. But of course, you have done entire semester on signals and systems. Now, systems or system theory, as it is called, actually does deal with, it deals with systems and plants, and the methodology that is adopted to analyze and design the basic methodology is actually taught to you in signals and systems in the system theory part, right? So anyway, I will be giving you a brief introduction today as far as the first class is concerned. So, okay. So slide number 5, right? So basically, to make our life easier, people use certain sorts of mechanisms which help them to attain certain objectives, right? So what I'm saying is that, let me just read out from the slide first. The complexity of problems of a man's existence is growing at an ever increasing rate. So earlier he used to actually spend a lot of time doing jobs which involved manual labor. But nowadays we have become sort of, you can say, lazy, or you can also say that we are trying to save time for other work, not essentially always very sort of productive, but anyway, we think so. Like maybe you're just scanning your website, social media websites, but whatever, you save time by using trying to use certain mechanisms. So basically, nowadays, what person would have done is that he would have used a machine, that is a washing machine, to wash his clothes instead of going into the manually intensive job of washing it himself. Now, that actually happens in most of the spheres today. Human effort and capacity is replaced by machines and control systems wherever possible, so that these may be employed to other problems where it is indispensable. So what that means is that, we try to make our life easier by replacing the labor that we put in by machines which are able to do the repetitive work for us, as such that we are able to use our energy for something else. So two examples are shown over here. One is the washing machine, which is used for washing clothes, would be employing, it is a system, and it would be employing some sort of control in it, right? Similarly, the second system that is shown over here is an air conditioner. So air conditioner is a temperature, it employs a temperature control system. So it actually is an on off temperature control system. What you essentially do is set the temperature to lie within a specific range. So the setting is in your hands. Say, for example, you want the temperature in your room to be within 18 degrees and 22 degrees. So you make the setting. So now the control system inside this, that air conditioner will take care of the rest, meaning that it has been designed such that the moment the air in your room, the temperature in the air in your room exceeds 22 degrees, the air conditioner is going to be, the compressor is going to be switched on. And the moment the temperature falls below the specified, the lower value of the range, the compressor is going to be switched off. So basically, the air conditioner employs what we call an automatic control system. And for that matter, it is specifically an on-off control system. On-off control system meaning that the controller will either put the compressor on or off, depending on the knowledge it gains gains about the temperature of the room by means of the sensors. So sensors are actually measuring instruments which sense the temperature of the room. So in this particular, that is air conditioner system, you would be having temperature sensors which would be sensing the temperature, and accordingly the controller with either switch on or off. So that is of course a specific example, but control systems would essentially try to make our life easier by performing in a certain fashion, that is by performing in a certain way and meeting certain performance objectives. So So basically, if we use control systems, we get more efficient and accurate control of desired quantities. And control systems play a vital role in the advancement of science and technology. So now we will actually go into a few examples of control systems before actually going into the topic itself. So some application areas are over here. So you can see in space vehicle, in missile guidance, pilotless aircraft, process control, industrial control, biological control, econometrics, etc., etc. Lots of applications, areas in which control systems are applied. Right? So on the right hand side, you see some photographs which are taken from the net, such as satellite or UAV or an industrial process. All of these would be employing some sort of controller, I mean, and that would employ control systems. So we will go into some of these examples. In a bit more of, we'll just touch. I think I have some photographs of one or two, or we'll be explaining another one or two. So over here on this slide now, you see the Mars exploration rover, which obviously will be making use of a control system. Why? Because, it would have to, first of all, successfully land on the surface of Mars, and then to explore around, keeping certain objectives in mind. Maybe somebody's, NASA is searching for water on the surface of the Earth. So, keeping those objectives in mind now, there would be, use of control systems within the rover itself, right? Say an artificial satellite. So for navigation of the artificial satellite, control systems would have to be used. So this is a satellite where you find that it has been launched, first of all, from the surface of the Earth. So it has to, calculations have been sort of made to what sort of velocity with which it should be launched and so on, and what would be the height, where it is going to orbit and so on. And now after it is, say, for example, after it has been navigated to the desired height and it has been set in orbit, even then control systems have to be used. Why? Because you see over here, the solar panels are visible on this satellite. And these solar panels at all times should be so positioned so that the surface is facing the sun. Right. Otherwise, they are not going to work, and the source of power for this satellite, you will not have any source of power, because if you are not using solar power, then just to supply power, heavy equipment have to be included over there in the form of batteries or some sort of cells and so on. So in that case, that would increase the weight over here. So naturally, people prefer solar power. Now, in order to make the solar panels always face towards the sun, naturally this satellite, now remember that this is in space, not on the surface of the Earth. So how do you know that it is oriented in a certain fashion? It is very difficult. With reference to what will you, actually see the orientation? There, of course, is a complicated, mechanism for calculating the orientation in space, right? So basically, now, given that the calculation also is done, if, say, for example, this gets disoriented, the orientation is somehow disturbed, again, it has to have a mechanism, a control systems would a system would have to be inside so that the satellite position is brought back to the original or desired position, irrespective of the disturbances which have displaced it. So that applies to anything. Maybe it has a camera which is going to film the surface of the Earth for the existence of water or clouds or whatever be the objective of this, or maybe it is trying to map the terrain or population. Whatever it is, the orientation to keep the orientation in a certain fashion, the satellite has to make use of a control system internally. Okay, combat aircraft. So basically, this is, you can see LCA is written over here. That is the light combat aircraft. Now it is known as Tejas, right? So combat aircraft or the commercial aircraft, all of them would have to make use of control systems. For each and every step, they would be requiring control systems, so that certain objectives are met. For industrial processes, like say, for example, an oil refinery as shown over here, or a chemical processing plant, you would be requiring control systems at each and every step. So internally, there would be multiple control systems controlling many aspects of such a such an oil refinery or such an industrial process or industrial system setup. Now, this is actually, you see the heading tells you biological control. Now, as far as control systems are concerned, control systems may actually be physically sort of present, in the sense that you can see the controller itself, right? In some form or the other, either hardware or software. Or it may also not be having a physical nature. It is conceptual in nature. So biological control is one such aspect which control engineers are interested in, and they can actually do the control. But I mean, it the biological control is not a physical system that you can see or touch or take in your hands and scrutinize. What we mean is that, say for example, there are pests over here, right? So insects which are eating away the leaves, and some sort of control, some sort of reduction has to be done in the number of insects, right? So what will be done is that pesticides are going to be employed over there. Now, how is the output going to be measured? Output maybe is going to be measured in the form of how much crop is produced and so on. So now, if we see that application of a particular pesticide has reduced the crop either quantity or decreased the quality, made the quality worse, in that case, what would be done is that a decision would have to be taken that the pesticide should not be applied in that amount. So a decrease would have to be made. So after the decrease is made, again, the output quality is seen, or quantity is seen. And then again, a decision would be made regarding whether to decrease the use further or to make it, increase the quantity of the pesticide. So over there, now you must have understood that what is being done is, yes, there is a control, but that control is not, the controller or the control as such, or for that matter the system itself, is not of a physical nature. Okay, you can still use your control system analysis tools by drawing some sort of representation of this system, and then going for a controller design, and then analysis of what is happening if you are applying a particular type of controller. All that can be done on pen and paper or by using your computer if you wish. But the system as well as the controller is not something which is physical, in the sense that over here you are interested in the yield of the crop, and the system, of course, you can see the plants over here, but the biological system by itself includes your plants, the soil, your the pests, and everything together. So it is more of a conceptual nature. Why I've said this in this much of detail is that do not be under the impression that control system is only some sort of machinery which you can actually see or design or something. You can still design a controller to control it, or but it may not be physical in nature as with the system itself. next we come to another example, which is a refrigerator. I've already spoken about the air conditioner example. Refrigerator would be similar to that. So, I mean, over here again, the temperature within the refrigerator would have to be maintained within a particular range. So there would be a controller which is doing the job. And again, over here in the refrigerator, you would be having an on-off control system, which is going to switch on or off a compressor, which is going to, I mean, do the job of cooling the refrigerator. Okay, here you see a DVD player. A sort of photograph is put over here where some parts have been labeled. Now, as far as the DVD player is concerned, this is what is called the head. Now, this head has to be positioned at a, but this is the disc. I hope all of you have seen the CD or the DVD discs, which look like this, the golden or brown portion that you see over here. Now, this head has to be positioned at a particular point on this surface, such that the information or data that is encoded at that particular point can be read. So red means READ. Okay, so in order to do that now, basically, what would be done is that this disc will be rotating, and this head also would, your head would have to be positioned at a particular point over here. So if now, if you would, I mean, have to position this head at a particular point, it would require a precise sort of what we call a position control system, meaning that positioning means that, I mean, you would have to actually, I mean, position this at a particular point. So, I mean, the calculation regarding where exactly it has to be placed would require a position control system. So, you have, okay, so you, it employs a control system in order to do that job. Next, we have the example of an automobile where there are, you can see the figure, I'm sure. This is, of course, downloaded from the net. Now, as far as the automobile or the car is concerned, you see that there are several control systems inside that single car, right? So I will just point out one or two. I hope it is visible. So you can see, first of all, the engine control is written over here. So the engine itself will have an engine control system, right? Now, if you have, okay. Okay. Here you find an adaptive cruise control, which is going to take care of if, say, for example, you want your car to actually have a constant velocity, right? So you set the velocity and then the car will be put on the cruise control or the autopilot, as it is called. And basically now, I mean, without you having to lay your hands on the steering or for that matter on the accelerator or the brake, the car by itself will cruise along at that particular velocity that you have set. So in that case, the cruise controller is going to be taking all the decisions regarding whether, say, for example, if the friction on the road surface has increased, naturally the car will slow down. So the cruise controller will make an effort to increase the velocity, and vice versa, meaning that if the car is going down a slope, the tendency would be that the velocity will automatically increase. So the cruise controller will do the job of decreasing the velocity to counter that, so that a constant velocity is maintained, right? Now, okay, so apart from that, you can see the others. Okay, so is it okay? So windshield wiper control. So okay, on the windshield there is a wiper, pair of wipers, one or two wipers. Earlier we essentially had two. Nowadays some cars do have one as well. But now your windshield shield wiper by itself will require a controller. So the moment you switch on the wiper, the wiper controllers are going to control the movement of the wiper, right? So that will be a separate controller for that system. Now here you find active vibration control. So the wheels are going to take in all the vibration and shock. So there will be a vibration controller, which is going to control the amount of vibration, right? Then you find over here electric power steering, power steering, if it is there, it's there. Electronic throttle control. So throttle by itself will, have a separate controller, which is going to control the throttle only, right? Then you can see over here, I'm not reading out the rest of it, it's going to take the whole day, as you can see from this. So you can see the transmission control, seat position control, active yaw control, electronic stability control, etc., etc., etc. All aspects of the car that we are using as a luxury item, all of them require some sort of control, right? They may be, the controllers may be coupled to one another or may be standalone controllers, meaning that, say for example, the wiper control by itself is going to work. Okay, so it does not have to be coupled with anything else. On the other hand, say for example, the engine control would have to also, coordinate with the throttle control. So basically, such dependencies or, independence would be there in the control actions, but nevertheless, there are several controllers which are required. So this is, of course, a single example that we've shown over here. Any industrial process will have such several controllers or control systems to perform the task for which it has been designed. Okay, so here on this slide, I'll just quickly go through most of the items apart from a few which require special sort of mention. So that, do you have a class from 3:30 today? I don't think so, isn't it?
No, ma'am, we don't have classes.
Okay, so I'll just try to extend by a bit to finish off this portion. So, basically you can see, in 1770, James Watt invented the flyball governor, right? So a flyball governor, are you familiar with the flyball governor? What does it do? You can see, of course, to control the speed of the steam engine. Actually, I had an animation, but unless I show in the full screen mode, it will not be visible. Let me see whether it is possible for me to show once more. I'll just try. In order to do that, I'll have to stop presenting this one and present my full screen. Let me see once. Okay, I'll just stop the presenting once. I'll try to go to the full screen mode if possible. If not, I'll come back to this mode. Is the entire screen visible now? Can you see?
Yes,
it?
Ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Achha. Okay. So actually, but the pointer is not showing. Okay. Can you see the slide with the flyball governor on it?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. I hope you can see that, the movement, the motion over here. Now, this is a flyball governor, as it is called. Many of you would have studied it at the school level. At least earlier, when we were school students, it was taught in class, I think, when 6 or 7 or 8, when the first time people used to study physics, they used to study this. But anyway, so now, as far as this flyball governor goes, those of you who are familiar with it, fine. If not, it just, listen to what I'm saying. So over here, now this is a representation, sort of of the fly ball governor and how it is working, how it works. Here you find this is the wheel. I hope you can see the cursor. If not, let me know. This is supposed to represent the wheel. So you can see that the fly ball governor is actually, I mean, directly coupled to the axis of the wheel. Now here you see that by the means of a coupling mechanism, this, I mean, the axis over here is coupled to this portion, which you see has a marking, which is the valve that regulates the amount of fuel. So this disc-like thing over here, the brownish, you can say, the disc is actually a valve which is going to open or close, and accordingly the amount of fuel which is, I mean, allowed to go through this is increased or decreased. So now, as far as the working is concerned, if say the velocity of the car is more, it is expected that the wheels of the car are going to rotate faster, right? So if the wheel rotates faster, what will happen? The moment the wheel rotates faster, the fly balls are going to fly apart. So they are going to actually fly apart, this position, right, that you see. I don't know whether there is a lag, but what I'm trying to say is they are going to, these pair of balls are going to fly apart. Now, flying apart, you will see, would imply that this is coupled via this mechanism to the valve, and the valve opening now will close. So you see, corresponding to the time where the fly balls are far apart, if you see certain, one or two cycles, you will see when the wheels are like this one. When the wheels are apart, the valve position closes. Of course, it doesn't close fully, that is there. But this is the open position, which is perpendicular to this opening over here. This opening, I mean. Okay, so basically, this is the open position, and the closed position is this one, when the disc is almost, covering this opening. So basically now, when the wheels are rotating faster, the fly balls are going to fly apart, and as a result of that, the your valve is going to close. So lesser amount of fuel will flow, and lesser amount of fuel, flowing would imply that the speed is going to decrease, meaning because the amount of fuel flowing is decreased, there will be a decrease in the velocity of the car and hence the wheel. Here, of course, simplistic assumption has been made, that is, when the velocity of the car is more, the your angular velocity of the wheels also will increase, and vice versa, which is of course true to a substantial extent, but not exactly. It's not going to, it may not be telling for different reasons, which I'm not going to discuss over here right now. But nevertheless, now when the wheels are like this, when the wheels are have a velocity which is slower, you will see that these fly balls are going to closing in means what? The valve is going to be in this position, that is the open position. That means more fuel will be allowed, which would increase the amount of fuel which is burning, and hence increase the velocity of the car. So this mechanism, that is a fly ball governor, is an example, the earliest example of an automatic control system. No person is involved over here. Nobody actually needs to go and open and close the valve over here. But by virtue of the system itself, because of the proper the mechanism, the velocity of the car, depending on the velocity of the car, appropriate action is going to be taken so that near constant velocity is maintained. Near constant means that if within, of course, a certain range, but if the velocity decreases, an effort will be made to increase it, and vice versa. And that effort that I have spoken of is an automatic effort that is being made by virtue of the design of the system itself. So this fly ball governor is the earliest example of an automatic control system. So In 1770, James Watt invented this flyball governor. And of course, I mean, when he invented it, he was, more interested in the operational aspect. He did not actually study the equations and analyze what is happening, look at the responses and so on, like we are going to do in our course, or like control engineers today analyze control systems. But he actually was a practical person, and he invented it just by the mechanics of it, and implemented it for controlling the speed of the steam engine. Next, of course, you can see a gap of around 100 years when Maxwell was able to explain the instabilities exhibited by the flyball governor by using differential equations to describe the control system. So you can see that a practical person, James Watt, invented the mechanism, that is the flyball governor, in 1770, whereas almost 100 years later, Maxwell was able to explain by, writing down differential equations. Right, so that is actually how control systems works. Practical people are the ones who are able to, by means of their intuition as well as a lot of knowledge goes into it, by means of those capabilities, they are able to do the design even without going into the sort of complicated or precise calculations. Whereas on the other hand, the other aspect also is required, like Maxwell, because he tried to explain what was happening, and that could be done only by the theoretical path, that is by using the differential equations. As far as control systems is concerned, both the paths are equally important. Of course, over here for this course, we would have to do a lot of our theoretical analysis as well, naturally. But when you are working in the field, your ability will be judged not only by your ability to do calculations which are complicated or whatever, but also to intuitively say, okay, do this, do that, and it will serve your purpose, right? Next, of course, after that, during World War I, importance of control systems was greatly felt. In 1920, Minorsky was the person who designed a system for automatic steering of ships and positioning of guns on shipboards. So during the World Wars, actually, World War I specifically, control systems, people got more and more interested in how to do the things, in the sense that, okay, a gun was positioned on the shipboard. Now, once it is positioned, the target is changing direction, changing position. So the positioning of the gun would automatically have to be changed according to the target direction. So naturally, people became more interested, more and more interested in automatic control system. Similarly, for steering of ships, of course, ships were there long time, from a long time earlier. But automatic steering came into being during this period, that is 1920. Next, this person, that is Hazen, in 1934, attempted to develop something which is known as a servo mechanism. Now, this is put within quotation mark because a servo mechanism is the earliest form of a control system as we know it now. So, I'll just show you. Here, you find that, what is a servo mechanism? Now, a servo mechanism is a feedback control system in which some mechanical position, velocity, or acceleration is the quantity of interest. So over here, you see there is a sheet of metal, and this cutter is cutting holes into it and cutting it into pieces as well. So positioning of this cutter is of importance. So where to position it will be done by using a servo mechanism, right? So basically, can you see me still? I hope so. If not, let me know. Okay. See me means see the slide, because I can hear some noises in the background. Now, in general, this is of course a specific example where you see a machine for speed, punch, and cut mechanism for converting a spool of raw material into sections. So basically, the raw material over here is continuous in nature, whereas here you find, it is being cut into sections and maybe a hole is punched into it. That's the specific sort of mechanism being shown over here. But nevertheless, the control aspect of it involves positioning the cutter at a desired position, right? So that would, in this particular case, also involve the increasing or decreasing the velocity of this job over here. Because if the velocity increases for this job, what will happen? You will get, pieces which are of wider size, right? And similarly, and vice versa, meaning if the velocity decreases, you will get, sizes which are lesser in width. So what we are trying to emphasize over here is that a servo mechanism will be dealing with some sort of mechanical position, velocity, or acceleration. I think I have another slide over here. Okay. So this figure you will see in many of the books that have been referred to, possibly in Kuo or some of, most probably in Kuo or Ogata, you would find this sort of a servo mechanism which is drawn. Now this is a remote positioning system for a radar antenna. The radar antenna is shown over here, and then here just schematically you see that this is a sort of shaft which is attached to a gearing arrangement, and then a motor, and on this side the position sensor, the controller, and the control panel. So of course I have not explained it in a systematic fashion. Now the objective over here is to position this antenna in a desired direction. So in order to do that, positioning is of interest to us. And how is it going to be done? It is going to be done by changing the velocity, by controlling rather the velocity of the motor over here, or the positional orientation of the motor, which in turn is going to control the rotation of the gearing arrangement, and hence the shaft of the antenna. Now how is it going to do it? You find that here there is a position sensor which is going to actually sense the antenna position, send send the information. The position sensor is going to send the information to a controller, and then the controller is going to accordingly send signal to the motor whether or not to change the orientation of the antenna or not. Nevertheless, this would be employing what we call a servo mechanism. So a servo mechanism is a traditional term applied to describe a closed loop electromechanical control system. By closed loop, you can see that the sensor over here is sensing the directional orientation and sending it back to the controller, which is going to give the appropriate signal to the motor. So if the sensor were not there, the system would have been, and this signal, this path would have not have been there. It would have been what we call an open loop control system. But in that case, automatic positioning of this antenna would not have been possible. However, over here, as it is a servo mechanism, it is a closed loop control system. So the moment and the orientation over here is changed, position sensor picks it up, sends the signal to the controller, and then gives an appropriate signal to the motor. Say, for example, the desired position has been overshot, the motor has to rotate such that correction will be made. Or if it has not gone to the desired position, requires to be rotated more, motor will be given a sort of signal by the controller that it has to rotate more. So all that is going to be done automatically by means of the servo mechanism, by means of the design of the servo mechanism. So let me read it out once again. A servo mechanism is the traditional term applied to describe a closed loop electromechanical control system that directs the precise movement of a physical object such as a radar antenna or a robot arm. So over here, a radar antenna has been shown, could have been a robot arm as well. Typically, either the position or velocity or both is controlled. So, I mean, what makes it a servo mechanism is that we are interested in the directional orientation, meaning the angular position is of interest to us. So that is why it is called a servo mechanism. Okay, so these were two examples, or rather, yes, specific examples of where a servo mechanism could be used. There could be several other applications. I think I have another figure somewhere when I go back to the slides. Maybe it's going to come. So Hazen was the first person, and you can see in 1934, he actually attempted to develop not only the servo mechanism, but some general theory for the servo mechanism. Now, remember that, I mean, the first people who developed the theory, they had a huge task at hand, because, I mean, we are just studying the theory. That is fine. Somebody has already sort of written down things for us. But Hazen was the first person who developed some general theory for the servo mechanism. In 1940, basically, mathematical and analytical methods were developed and practiced, and control system engineering or control engineering was established as an engineering discipline in its own right. So till then, basically, practical engineers designed control systems. Some actually tried to analyze control systems, but nobody sort of gave recognition to the fact that control systems engineering or control engineering had to be studied as a specific subject. So, I mean, control systems engineering being established as an engineering discipline in its own right was done in the 1940s only. 1950s, of course, with the advent of computers, both analog and digital, naturally control systems improved. So, highly sophisticated control systems have been devised and implemented. So, these figures already have been shown to you. So, okay. Now, coming to this slide, that is classical control theory versus modern control theory. So now you have already studied system theory, or at least a part of it, in your signals and systems. Did you have the class for signals and systems at all in your second years?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So in that part, that system part, you must have done some sort of state variable analysis and some transfer functions, and maybe you are familiar with some sort of systems. Now, I'm assuming that that knowledge is there, then fine. So now, control theory developed in the 1950s used to deal with single input, single output systems. So whenever we speak of a system, if we are analyzing it from the classical control theory point of view, we will be treating it as a single input, single output system. So single input, single output system, I mean, how is that sort of relevant? We have to actually have knowledge about the system, and then we would have to identify which output is of importance to us and what is the reference or input signal which is being applied. So now, I mean, the system by itself is treated as a single output and single input, or rather the other way around is what we say it as, single input, single output, or CISO system. So any system is treated as a CISO system as far as classical control theory is concerned. Now, you are familiar with certain ways of modeling systems. Which model that you are familiar with, namely, say, the transfer function model or the state variable or state space model, which of those two actually look at systems as CISO, having a CISO nature? Which one? I'll repeat my question. We have, I mean, systems, say, and systems can be modeled in the form of mathematical models. For example, your transfer function form or the state variable form are two such models, two such ways in which control systems can be modeled. They can be modeled in several other ways, like you can have a set of differential equations to express your control system. That is a different issue, or system for that matter. You are not familiar with control systems so far, but systems you know. So what I'm saying is that out of the transfer function model and the state space model, which model treats the system as a CISO system?
Transfer function model.
Yes, right. So as far as transfer functions are concerned, wherever you are dealing with a system and looking at transfer functions, you are actually approaching it from the classical control theory point of view, right? So whatever be your control system, you have to identify which output is of interest to you, what is the input, and then you sort of close your eyes to whatever is happening. Of course, close your eyes means all those are embedded within the model. You should not be saying close your eyes. The dynamics are very much there. But what we look at explicitly is that we look at the system as a single input, single output. On the other hand, modern control theory that was, since the 1960s, used to look at a system from the point of view of it having multiple inputs and multiple outputs. So MIMO systems, the concept of MIMO systems and dealing with systems as having multiple inputs and multiple outputs came into being in the 1960s, and it was called, that branch was called modern control theory. So a person who is doing the analysis from the modern control theory point of view would treat a system as having multiple inputs and multiple outputs to take care of the increased complexity of the system. So increased complexity of the modern plants and involving a large number of equations. So those are there. Naturally, when you are modeling the system in the state variable form using state variables, that is the state space form is what you are using. Over there, you look at the system as having multiple inputs and multiple outputs, right? Of course, the two forms are interconvertible to a certain extent, provided you make certain assumptions. For example, if you have a system in the state space form, you have to, be sure about which output you are interested in, which input you are interested in, and then you can get the equivalent transfer function model in terms of that particular output and that particular input only, right? So, that is possible conversion with certain assumptions and restrictions in place, of course. But nevertheless, as far as this particular course is concerned over here, that is your linear control system, we will be concentrating more or less sticking to the classical control theory point of view. Some other examples which we will just quickly go through before ending today's class, then we'll continue the next class. So some other examples of control systems are traffic control system, driving system of an automobile, autopilot, which steers the rocket vehicle in response to a radio command, a chemical process, economic inflation dynamics. So of which the traffic control system, I'll just show you something which is more or less representative, you can say. So here, you have the streets are shown over here, and you see that at the intersections or the junctions, there are traffic signals. Now, if somebody would have wanted to, design a controller which is going to automatically take care of the changing of the signals, then they could do it, of course. So they could do it, but the branch of control systems that they would be using for such a study or such a design is known as sequential control systems, right? So sequential control systems and modulating control systems are two specific branches of control systems, of which we will be more or less, as far as this course is concerned, we will be sticking to modulating control systems, right? On the other hand, this particular example is an example of a sequential control system. Actually, in your course, in third year, probably in this semester or the next one, you do have microprocessors and sequential systems and so on, some subjects which are related to sequential control. Now, as far as this course over your linear control system is concerned, we are not going to deal with sequential control systems at all. But as far as the traffic control system is concerned, it is a control system. And I mean, systematically changing of lights have to take place depending on certain input information. So it may be that, I mean, a simple timer mechanism is what makes the lights change in a specific order. So it may be that the your lights at this junction are coupled to the lights at this junction and the lights at the next junction. So when, I mean, this one is green, maybe the next one should turn yellow, the third one should turn red. So it is, I mean, if depending on your requirement, it does involve a lot of designing, but the whole thing falls into the area of sequential control systems. On the other hand, we are going to stick to modulating control systems, which do not have any sequential components. Okay, not much value addition on this slide, I think. Just showing the red and then it will be yellow and green. So, I mean, the change of lights takes place in a particular sequence. That is the thing that I wanted to show on this slide. So, I think I will be ending today's lecture over here with this one. The next class, we will be starting with open loop control systems, closed loop control systems, and so on. So, let me just stop the recording first. And also stop the sharing. Okay, before stopping the sharing, is there anything that you would like to ask or discuss? Otherwise, by default, we will be having the next class on next Thursday, this usual slot, that is 2:30 to 4. That is the preferable slot. If you do have a class from 3:30 onward, but I mean, unless the scheduled class, that is MM takes the class, do not give it to somebody else. That's it. What I mean to say is that we have the control linear control system class after this. So naturally, I would be taking it, or MM may be wanting to take it. That's a different issue. But apart from that, don't let anybody, at least up to 4, you keep it free for me so that I can extend the class up to 4 each day. Okay, so that's all I wanted to say. If there's something you want to discuss, you can ask me. Or I think nobody has joined late. Is there anybody who has joined late and hasn't given their attendances? I'll just stop the presentation. If there are no queries, then of course, that's all. Thank you. Okay.